I got a tweet 7 days ago from a friend. I had just blasted out a notice that Rick Warren was unable to come and that our new guest speaker was Max Lucado. And a friend sent me a note saying, best plan B in history. Yeah. By way of introduction, I do want to mention that this is not really plan B. It sort of turned out that way. But when I was named the new director of the Pepperdine Bible Lectures, the very first person I invited 15 months ago from now was Max Lucado. But because Max is on an annual discipline for his book that rolls out, this is just not a time of year that he could come. So 15 months ago, he told me no for 2013. 6 months ago, I asked him 18 months in advance for 2014. But again, because of his discipline in writing and his devotion to his church and his family, he told me no. But 7 days ago, when I wrote him and said, Max, you know Rick has lost his son and he's just made what I think is a wonderful decision to back out and take a 3-month speaking sabbatical, speaking as one who's buried a child, and you're my first choice if that's at all possible. And within an hour, I had an email that I love saying, Mike, give me a call. And so it goes back to that. So thank you, Max. I did want to mention, this is not the first favor Max has done for me. Back in the late 1980s, I wrote a book, and there was a young missionary in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, who had just published a book called On the Anvil. He was about to move to San Antonio. I really liked his writing, so I asked Max to write the foreword to my book, which he did. By that time, they'd moved to San Antonio. I called another buddy of mine preaching at another San Antonio church and said, I want to really put on the dog to thank him. So tell me the best restaurant in San Antonio, and I'm going to buy a gift certificate. So I bought a $50 gift certificate, and I sent it to Max. And Max went to this restaurant, do you remember? And it didn't have prices on it. You remember that? It had no prices, but Max was as much of a bumpkin as I was at the time, and he thought, I've got a $50 gift certificate. So he and Dinalyn ordered everything and got a nice dessert and a little coffee afterwards, and he told me later they had to wash dishes to get out of there. So I want you to know I got another $50 gift certificate waiting here, but don't spend it at Duke's. Max was for years a missionary in Rio de Janeiro, along with Dinalyn. 1988, they moved to San Antonio, where he has been minister for the Oak Hills Church since then. Max has written almost 100 books. There are about 80 million copies of his books in print in every imaginable language. He was named by Christianity Today as America's pastor, which I think is appropriate. What's that? I thought you knew. And we're so thankful to Dinalyn sharing him at last moment. And they have 3 daughters, Jenna and Andrea and Sarah. We're grateful for them and the wonderful young women they are. I got to teach a couple of them. But I'd like to pray now and ask God's blessings on Max, especially on this busy day of travel that he's had and that many of you have had. We are grateful, God, for Max's life, for his voice, for his pen, and especially for his heart. We're grateful for the way that he has shaped people in the way of Jesus by word and by life. And I pray that you will bless him as he teaches. We are so grateful to be here to learn, to share. May the Lord bless him now. In the name of Christ, we pray. And we all say, amen. Amen. Would you welcome Max Lucado?
Well, good afternoon, everybody. Well, we made it, didn't we? Here we are. This morning when I woke up in San Antonio, there was a voicemail from American Airlines saying the flight was delayed. And so I just poured another cup of coffee. And I sent a message to Mike. I said, you know, if you want to go ahead and go with another plan. He told me, he said, a minute ago, he said, well, I've already done that once. And so I just pulled in, and I'm really, really grateful to be here. And it turns out to be a phenomenal opportunity for me to just publicly acknowledge my condolences to my friend Rick Warren, and the deep and long-lasting respect I have for him and Kay, and may God continue to bless and to heal them. And what a privilege to be a part of this event, which is Mike's first time serving as wrangler of this event, following our dear friend Jerry Rushford. And it's just great to be here to wish him the best and pray the best on his ministry as he serves all the people of the kingdom and all the people who come to this great event. I just can't pull on the campus without having all these memories come back of some of the sweetest people in the world. Norval Young. I always think of Norval Young when I come on the pet. Am I alone in that? My favorite line of Norval Young's was this: we're living in a day of answered prayer. We're living in the day of answered prayer. I may be misquoting that, but that's how I remember it. And we are, aren't we? We're living in a difficult time, for sure. But this is a day of answered prayer. And Jerry Rushford, my goodness, what a good man. And my favorite line from Jerry's is how Jerry would conclude the lectures every year. And he would always use this line. It was something like this: if you look long and hard enough, you will find something wrong with this week. I've used that with my church several times. You know, if you look long and hard enough, you're going to find something wrong everywhere you go. That's true in life. But you know, it's hard to find something wrong with the Pepperdine lectures. And may God continue to bless this great history, this great legacy. Bill Banowski, I pulled up, I hadn't thought about Bill Banowski in forever, and Bill Young, and all the great shoulders upon which we stand today in our own faith. Many of you influenced by them and by the many, many speakers who have come through here over these many, many years. What a vision even to have this wonderful university. And it's just an honor for me to have a small part in it. I do bring you greetings from San Antonio, Texas. They are so glad when I leave town. They have had their fill of me. I've been there 25 years. 25 years. That's a long time. And they're just so happy when we have guest speakers. The other day, I was after the service, it's been about 3 or 4 weeks ago, a young man came up to me, maybe 13 or 14 years old, and he said, I just want to tell you, that's the worst sermon I've ever heard you preach. Why are you laughing? I said, what? He came up to me about a week later, and he said, I was wrong last week. Well, in an elders meeting not long thereafter, I said to the elders, I said, you got to do something about this kid. He's really discouraging me. And one of the elders said, oh, Max, don't pay him any mind. He only repeats what he hears. We have those hand dryers in our bathrooms, you know, you hit the button and a burst of hot air comes out. Somebody wrote on a sticky note and put it on one of those for a brief message from our minister, hit this button. And they're always telling me my sermons are too long. You probably never have to put up with long sermons, but they're always telling me my sermons are too long. Not too long ago, right in the middle of one of my messages, somebody, a gentleman, stood up and he started walking out. I stopped everything. I said, sir, where are you going? He said, I'm going to get a haircut. I said, well, why didn't you get one before you came in? He said, I didn't need one before I came in. That's ruthless, isn't it? My favorite joke these days, my wife tells me not to tell, but since she's not here, I'm going to tell it. It's a story about a guy who goes into a doctor's office to have a mole removed from his chin. He tells the nurse, who's somewhat of a husky sort, I'm here to have a mole removed from my chin. She didn't even look up. She said, down the hall, first door to the right, remove all your clothes and sit down. He said, I'm just here to have a mole removed from my chin. She's kind of gruff lady. She said, I said, down the hall, first door to the right, remove all your clothes and sit down. He said, ma'am, maybe you don't understand. She looked up. She said, maybe you don't understand. Down the hall, first door to the right, remove all your clothes and sit down. Well, a bit intimidated, he went down the hall, first door to the right, opened the door. Lo and behold, there's a naked man sitting on a stool in the corner. He said to the naked man, quite a nurse out there. And the man said, you're telling me I'm just a UPS driver. I don't know why she doesn't like that joke. I can't come to California without thinking of my Uncle Billy. Now, Uncle Billy lived in Anaheim for most of his adult life, even though he was raised with where my father was raised in West Texas. But at a young age, Uncle Billy got a job with the Santa Fe Railroad and moved to California prior to World War II. And he spent all of his adult years in Anaheim. It was a big day when my dad told the Lucado family back in West Texas, we're all going to California on vacation to see Uncle Billy. I was 10 years of age. I'd never been to California. I had never seen an ocean. Now, many of you find that hard to believe. I've shared that story with people, and they say, are you kidding? You lived to be 10 years of age, and you'd never seen an ocean? I had never seen a lake that was larger than a city block. I'd seen a lot of cattle tanks and horse troughs. I'd never really seen a river. I'd seen creeks. So you can imagine. Can you imagine what it must be like for a 10-year-old boy to see the Pacific Ocean? I can still remember. I almost think I could find the place. I know I couldn't. But it's indelibly stenciled in my memory, standing on a beach, looking at the immensity, the endless stretch, that horizon of water. And I turned to my Uncle Billy, watching those waves slap against the water and pull back out, waves slap and then pull back out. I turned to him and I said, Uncle Billy, it just keeps coming. You see, if you've never seen an ocean, not only have you never seen the immensity of it, you've never seen waves like that. He said to me, I know. He said, this happens at night too. And he said, if you were to come back in December, it keeps coming. My brother and I went swimming for the first time in the ocean. We had our bathing suits on. We waded out in the water. Never felt anything like it. Struggled to get back up to my feet. Got back up on my feet. It just kept coming. Did you know that there is a grace of God that just keeps coming? That just when you think you've got it figured out, just when you think you've outsinned the grace, it just keeps coming. How long has it been since you've been soaked to the bone by the grace of God? There's something about this grace of God, this relentless, this rumbling, this tumbling, this pulling, this tide that just keeps coming. And to anyone who is willing to stand on the shoreline of God's hope, there is a grace that never stops. Maybe that's why the Apostle Paul was so committed to tell his young student Timothy, if you're going to be strong in anything, he said, be strong in the grace that is yours in Christ Jesus. And then that admonition in Hebrews, it says, see to it that no one misses the grace of God, and that no bitter root springs up to defile many. Paul says, if you're going to be strong in anything, Timothy, be strong in the grace. Be muscular in the grace. Exercise in the workroom of grace. Be articulate in grace. Be swamped in grace. We all have our favorite stories of grace in the Bible, but since I'm preaching, I get to pick the one we're going to look at, right? You'll remember it. It's in John's Gospel, chapter 8. Early the next morning, Jesus was back again at the temple. A crowd soon gathered, and he sat down and he taught them. And while he was speaking, the teachers of religious law and Pharisees brought a woman they had caught in the act of adultery. And they put her in front of the crowd. Teacher, they said to Jesus, this woman was caught in the very act of adultery. And the law of Moses says to stone her. What do you say? The voices yanked her out of bed that morning. Get out of bed, you harlot. What kind of woman do you think you are? Voices of accusation and criticism. The priest slammed open the bedroom door and yanked back the curtains. And before she felt the warmth of the morning sun, she felt the heat of their religious scorn. They yanked back the covers and they pulled her out of bed. And they began to drag her through the narrow streets of Jerusalem. The roosters scampered to get out of the way, and the dogs barked. And the mamas reached out and pulled their children back just in time and covered their eyes. And the daddies turned and looked, and the merchants turned and stared. And if that parade of shame were not enough, they took the woman to, of all places, an early morning Bible study where Jesus had gathered in the square, in the open area with his followers. And the Bible says that he was seated. Jesus sat down. And so Jesus was sitting down, and probably his students were as well. And in my imagination, I can just see the religious leaders finally frocked and angry-faced, taking the woman and shoving her into the middle of the crowd. Maybe some of the students stood to get out of the way. And I'm imagining it was tough for her to maintain her balance. Maybe she couldn't. And there she fell face first, clutching her nightie, lipstick smeared, and a horseshoe of pastors and leaders gather around her. Teacher, they say, this woman was caught, snagged, grabbed, caught. That's a good verb we'll later learn. She really is a part of a trap, which may explain the absence of the man. I don't know. She's been caught. But really, she is the cheese, and we'll learn Jesus is the mouse. But she was caught to hopefully catch him. She's been caught in the act, in the moment, in the embrace, in the bed, caught in the act of adultery. And the law of Moses says we're supposed to throw rocks at her. Do you think by now that the men had begun to pick up stones? Is there any chance that as she From her position on the ground, looked up waist level with the men, she could see them squeezing these stones until their fingertips turned white. The law of Moses says we're supposed to stone her. What do you say? And from face to face to face, she looked and she didn't see any kindness, any compassion. Nobody's going to speak up for her. Nobody's going to help her. But somebody is going to stoop for her. You preachers, next time you preach John 8, use the postures of Jesus as your outline. John wants us to follow Jesus' varying elevations. He sat down to teach, but then John says, Jesus stooped down. He stooped down and he wrote in the dust. So the sitting Jesus becomes the stooping Jesus. Why do you think Jesus stooped down? And what do you think he wrote? Why did he stoop? And what did he write? Everybody's always wondered, haven't they? What was he writing in the ground? Billy Graham said, this is the only sermon Jesus ever wrote. What do you think he wrote in the dust? You can't have a Bible study on John 8 without somebody saying, what was he writing in the dust? I think I know. If you'll remind me at the end of the message, I'll tell you. Why did he stoop? John Stott said, grace is the God who stoops. I've wondered if it wasn't so that she would no longer be the lowest one in the circle. Because you see, everyone was looking down on her. Maybe you know what that's like. Maybe people have looked down on you in your life. Maybe you know what it's like to be at the low end of the pecking order, the bottom rung of the ladder. Maybe Jesus was going lower as if to say, all right, if you're going to look at me, you got to look even farther. He stooped. Grace is the God who stoops. Jesus was prone to do this, wasn't he? Prone to stoop low enough to be born in a stable, placed in a manger, low enough to be raised in a map dot of a town in nondescript Nazareth, to spend 3 decades in anonymity, God in the flesh. How low he stooped. He condescended. He entered our world. But they demanded an answer, John says. They just kept demanding an answer. Verse 7, they kept demanding an answer. So, what did he do? Stood up. So the sitting Jesus, who became the stooping Jesus, now becomes the standing Jesus. He stood up. Didn't stand for long because he's going to stoop down in just a moment. Again, using my imagination, I just see him standing, looking at her accusers, placing himself in between her and them. All right, he said. Stoner. Stoner. But let the one of you who has never sinned throw the first stone. Now, you got to really press your ear up against your Bible here. But if you do, and you press it real tight, and you tell everybody else to be very quiet, right about this point in John chapter 8, you'll begin to hear this. Drop. 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 One stone after another after another. They dropped their stones. And then John says, beginning, when they heard this, they slipped away one by one, beginning with the oldest. Again, another great detail, right, from John? You think our ever-balding heads and thinning hair cause us to have a better perspective of how much we've sinned? So these silver-haired guys turn, beginning with the eldest, one by one. They came in mass. They came in a posse. And they leave one by one by one. Can I have that rock back? Until only Jesus is left standing. He wasn't finished. He asked her the question in verse 10. He said, "Where are your accusers?" My, 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 what a question. Not just for her, but for us. I have a hunch that I'm speaking to somebody who, maybe even this morning, was awakened with voices of condemnation and accusation. You're not good enough. You're not strong enough. You don't give enough. You don't serve enough. You're not faithful enough. Oh, these voices that come in our world. And these voices in our head. Who is this morality patrolman who seems to issue a citation at every stumble? Does he ever shut up? You could do better. Why aren't you more like your friend, your spouse, your sister? Do these voices of accusation ever shut up? They don't. And here's why. Because they come from the devil. Yes, I believe there is a devil. I believe there is a malevolent, evil force who's on a short leash and a limited timetable. But he has one goal, and that is to suck the joy out of God's people. The Apostle John calls him the accuser. He said, "This great dragon, the ancient serpent called the devil or Satan, is the one deceiving the whole world, was thrown down to earth with all his angels. For the accuser has been thrown down to earth, the one who accused our brothers and our sisters day and night." Satan cannot take your salvation, but he tries to take your joy, your fruit, your faith, your happiness. He tries to take what he can. And he comes in as the accuser, whispering ever these voices in your ear, hoping to render you without happiness, without faith, without hope, and without security. And he's got a lot of demons to help him. And he recruits a lot of people to help him. Friends who dredge up your past, or preachers who preach all guilt and no grace, or even parents. One of my friends tells me that he thinks his mom must have owned a travel agency that specialized in guilt trips. He said she took me on a different one every day. Maybe you were raised in a home of condemnation. Maybe the earliest voices you heard were voices of criticism and accusation, and there's something in your system that's just hardwired to resist the idea of God's grace coming at you like a tidal wave, washing away, cleansing, changing, restoring, renewing. For some people, it's a lifelong project to learn to trust God's grace. In fact, for some people, that is the decision of discipleship. Not to do more, but to trust more. So what does Jesus do? I think he does for us what he did for the woman caught in the act of adultery. We know, right, that these stories are in the Bible not just to show us what Jesus did, but to show us what a living Jesus does right now. What did he do for her? He stooped. What does he do for you? He stoops.
He enters your world through the voice of a friend, through the embrace of a spouse, through the kindness of a scripture, even through the message of a preacher. He stoops to enter your world. Would you right now open yourself up to the very possibility that Jesus Christ, the King of the universe, is stooping to speak to your heart at this moment with comfort, with kindness? He stoops, just like he stooped to be born in Bethlehem and to walk the shores of Galilee and the streets of Jerusalem. He stoops. Grace is the God who stoops, who comes in. And you think you're low, he goes lower. He made himself to be sin for us, so that in him we could become the righteousness of God. Stoop low enough to be nailed to a cross, low enough to take a final breath and to shed that crimson blood for our sins. Stooped low. He stooped. But then what did he do? He stood to validate his coming is his standing. He stood right in the middle of the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. He stood. Stood right in defiance of the devil himself. He stood. Demons scattered, and Satan was last seen with tail tucked between legs, scampering out of the cemetery. He stood. He stood. And he spoke. And here's what you need to know. He's still speaking right now. At the right hand of God, you have what the woman had in Jerusalem. You know what you have? You have an advocate. You have an advocate, dear child of God. You have an advocate. Whoever lives to make intercession for you, who positions himself in between you and your accuser, whose job is to be your intercessor. And since he will live forever, he will always be there to remind God that he has paid for our sins with his blood, and that he is in the presence of God at this very moment doing what? Sticking up for us. So when Satan comes into the kingdom, into the throne room of the kingdom with his accusations, Jesus stands. And he comes between you and your accuser. And what Jesus did for her, Jesus does for you. But what Jesus does for you is even more than what he did for her. Wave upon wave, prepare yourself. Because Jesus gave her his help, but Jesus gives you his heart. His heart. That when you give your heart to Jesus, he returns the favor in a supernatural miracle, and he places within you and within me a brand new heart. I'm not telling you anything, just reminding you that in the Bible, the heart is symbolic of the want to and the can do, desire and ability. And so when God talks about giving a brand new heart to his people, he's saying, I'm going to give you new desires and new ability. So grace becomes more than just the word to describe what God did for us, but it becomes the word that describes what God does inside us. He moves in. You remember the Old Testament prophecy from Ezekiel 36, then I will sprinkle clean water on you and you shall be clean. I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and all your idols. There's wave one. But prepare yourself for wave number two. I will give you a new heart. I will put a new spirit within you. When you give Jesus your heart, the wonder of it all, he gives you his. He removes your heart, poisoned as it is with pride and pain and all the mistakes of the past. And he places within you a brand new heart. No other religion in the history of the world dares to make such a claim. No other movement implies the living presence of its founder in its followers. Muhammad does not indwell Muslims. Buddha does not inhabit Hindus. Joseph Smith does not indwell Mormons. Hugh Hefner does not indwell the hedonist. Influence, inspire, enable, instruct, but occupy. Yet we Christians embrace this inscrutable promise. Paul said, Christ in you. Christ in you. The hope of glory. Todd and Tara Storch really understand this as much as anyone might. Todd and Tara, wonderful family from Dallas, Texas. They were blessed with three children. And in the spring of 2010, they went on a family ski trip to Colorado. Their beautiful 13-year-old daughter, Taylor, died in a tragic accident on the mountain. And what followed for Tara and Todd was every parent's worst nightmare. A funeral, a burial, a flood of questions and tears. And they decided to donate their daughter's organs to needy patients. Few people needed a heart more than Patricia Winters. Her heart had begun to fail some 5 years earlier, leaving her too weak to do much more than sleep. But Taylor's heart gave her a fresh start on life. Tara, Taylor's mom, had only one request. She wanted to hear the heartbeat of her daughter one more time. Through a curious series of events, Patricia Winters and Tara Storch got in contact with each other. And Todd and Tara flew from Dallas to Phoenix to the home of Patricia. And the two mothers embraced for a long time, soon to be joined by Todd. After a few moments, Tara took the stethoscope and she placed it against Patricia's chest. There's a web page that tells this story. Taylorsgift.org recreates this moment in which Tara heard her daughter's heartbeat again. It's so strong, she said. Patricia said, oh yes, it's a strong heart. I want Todd to hear it, she said, and handed the stethoscope to her husband. And the two parents took turns listening to their daughter's heart. The reason I tell you that story is so I can ask you this question. When Todd and Tara heard that heartbeat, whose heart did they hear? Did they not hear the still beating heart of their daughter? Oh, dear child of God, when God hears your heart right now, whose heart does he hear? Does he not hear the still beating heart of his son, Jesus Christ? Because when you gave your heart to him, he returned the favor and placed within you the heart of Jesus Christ. This is the mystery of our faith. I don't know how I missed this for so many years. I believe that Christ was for me, near me, behind me, above me, beneath me, around me. I believed every other preposition. How did I go so long without the awareness that Jesus was in me? I can't fault the Apostle Paul. Paul refers to this union 216 times. If my wife tells me something three times, I'm supposed to get it. 216 times. One time, you're not going to believe this. One time he went so far as to say, "It is no longer I who lives, but Christ who lives where?" So you already read this. "But Christ who lives in me." Can you imagine getting to the point in your life where one morning you wake up and you look in the mirror and you say, "I don't think that's me anymore." But steady, day by day by day, the Christ who moved in has reclaimed what is rightfully his. My emotions, my thoughts, my mind, my hand, my want to, my can do. He has steadily, day by day by day, reclaimed what is rightfully his. And now as I look in the mirror, I don't even think what I used to think. I don't hate who I used to hate. I'm not as critical as I used to be. Is that me in the mirror? It is no longer I, but Christ who lives in me, who lives in me. You see, God's dream isn't just to get you to heaven, but to get heaven inside of you. A radical new nature indwells you, dear friend. A radical new nature indwells you. And as that nature grows and increases, you become less and less you and more him. Wave enough to wash away your sins, but the wave also enough to change you, to transform you from one degree of glory to the next. You say, "Max, that sounds good, but if I have Christ's heart in me, then why do I still behave so much like me? If I have his heart, why do I still have these habits?" Well, there's a good answer to that question. Transplants take time. Right? I have a guy, or a guy in our church, cardiologist, he performs a transplant average a week, heart transplant, real successful heart surgeon in South Texas. I asked him one day, just to make sure, I said, "If somebody has a heart transplant today, can they run a marathon tomorrow?" And he laughed at me just like you did. He chuckled. He said, "No." I said, "Does that mean then they did not get a new heart?" He says, "No, they got a new heart. It just has to acclimate." The presence of the struggle does not imply the absence of the miracle. It is a miracle that happens. Nothing short of a new birth that happens. That whenever somebody looks with faith toward the Christ who died for them, there is a miracle that happens. The struggles will continue, but here's the good news. They're going to diminish. It's one of my friends says, "I'm not sinless, but I am starting to sin less." Isn't this good news? Maybe you can't control your anxiety, but Jesus can, and he lives inside you. Maybe you can't stop gossiping, but Jesus can, and he lives inside you. Maybe you can't put up with that jerk who lives next door or forgive that person who broke your heart, but Jesus can. and he lives inside you. I got to tell you, folks, this is exciting stuff. And it is transforming this old boy you're looking at. I'm nearly 60 years old. I've been in ministry, entering my fourth decade as a minister. And I've got more energy now, more passion, more excitement, more optimism, because I'm learning that it is the ever-increasing, growing, glorious presence of Jesus Christ reclaiming what is rightfully his. And it's not so much what I do, but more who I trust. It's a mystery, I know. I'd love to package it and box it up and condense it all down to a page, but every time I think I do, wave upon wave. I think the Lord would like to douse you today. I do. And I just have a hunch. I'm looking into the faces of some really good people who do a lot. But something in my heart is saying, would you just be? Would you just at least for the rest of my message today, just be. Just be God's child. Just let him be inside you. Just trust him. Just receive him. Just believe him. He has moved into you. He must really think highly of you. I know you're a reclamation project just like I am. But he's doing a pretty good job. Last year, where are we? In May? Yeah, so it's been a full year now. Someone sent me a YouTube video of some girls who posted a tribute to their mother. I watched the YouTube video, and I emailed the guy who sent it. He's on our staff, and I said, that's a great story. He said, you don't know the half of it. He said, those two girls go to our church. I said, you're kidding me. And so I got in contact with him, and I asked him if I could take that video with me as I go and speak at different places, because as much as any story I've seen, it communicates the grace of Christ. Now, this is a Mother's Day tribute, and Mother's Day is just a few weeks away, a few days away, so it's especially appropriate now, right? It only takes 2 minutes. I want you to watch it, and then I'm going to come up and wrap the message up.
Thank you.
great story. So I went to the Verone house and I sat down with the three kids in Joy. The father, Christoph, was out of town. And I said, "Do you children have any doubt about your mother's love for you?" I know I ask the dumbest questions, don't I? But I wanted to hear them. I wanted to see the expression on their faces. They looked at me, the two girls and the little boy, Elliot, and they said, "No, she proved it." Do you have any doubt about God's love for you? Didn't he do for you what she did for her children? Placed himself between you and certain destruction and felt the pain of the fall so that you would never have to. Receive it, church. Receive it, servant. Receive it, disciple. Receive it. Just receive it. Be strong in the grace that is yours in Christ Jesus. Be more sponge and less rock. If I were to take this rock and put it in a basin of water and pull it out, it's wet, but how far has the water gone? It's not penetrated, has it? If I were to take this sponge, I learned this from washing dishes all these years. If I were to take this sponge and immerse it in the same water and pull it out, where's the water gone? So deep within that when you squeeze it, the only thing that comes out is water. God's desire for his children is that we would so immerse ourselves in his love and in his grace that even when we're squeezed, grace just drips out of us. And so Jesus looked around, and all the accusers had left, and it was just him and the woman. And on the ground were all of their stones, each one a tombstone marking the burial place of someone's pride. Jesus said, "Where are your accusers?" And she looked around. "Does no one accuse you?" And she said, "No one, sir." Can you imagine the point in life when you look up and say, "Hey, no accusations stick on me anymore." And Jesus said, "Then neither do I accuse you. Now go and sin no more. Move into a place of grace. Go and sin no more." And so she walked off the pages of Scripture, and Jesus stood with his disciples and walked away. But before we walk away, I need to fulfill a promise. I told you I would tell you what he wrote in the dirt. And so let's look and see. You know what Jesus wrote in the dirt? He wrote these words, "Grace happened here today." Maybe that's what he wrote. I don't know. But I know it did. I know grace happened then. And I'm praying that grace happens here to you. Dear Jesus, bless you, King. We adore you. We thank you. We acknowledge you. You're the only story worth telling. And yours is the only love really worth trusting. For it is so eternal, so weatherproof, so faithful, that even when we've turned away from you, you've never turned away from us. Lord Jesus, look kindly upon these your servants
who have come just for a fresh drink from the water fountain of your mercy and grace. All of us, Lord, tend to get tired, a bit weary. Let new waters come today. We bless you. In Jesus' name. And all the church said, amen. Amen.
Thank you so much, Max. He's actually got to step out the door. We've got to get him to a flight to go back home. Would you thank him one more time? Thank you, Max, for coming today. What an amazing message. I watched that video about 12 times so that I could hold it together afterwards. What a stunning story. I was thinking back, Shane Claiborne said that they taught this story of John 8 to some inner city kids in Philadelphia. And then they had a discussion, what did Jesus write on the ground? And one of the kids said he thought he knew. He thought Jesus wrote, "Lady, if this doesn't work, run." Which is also a possibility. Thank you so much for coming to this pre-conference. I had so looked forward to Rick Warren coming, but the prayers of this gathering will continue for Rick and Kay as they continue to mourn the sudden loss of their 27-year-old son, Matthew. I sent word to his assistant, Cody, just yesterday that the people at this conference would be praying for them, and I trust that you will. But I am so grateful to Max for being here. Now at 4:15, I hope to see many of you at the AWP dinner. Others maybe are scattering for dinner, but 6:15, back in here, Brandon Scott Thomas and Zoe will begin our night of singing and praise. I'll see you in just a little bit. Blessings. I got a tweet 7 days ago from a friend. I had just blasted out a notice that Rick Warren was unable to come and that our new guest speaker was Max Lucado. And a friend sent me a note saying, "Best Plan B in history." Yeah. By way of introduction, I do want to mention that this is not really Plan B. It sort of turned out that way. But when I was named the new director of the Pepperdine Bible Lectures, the very first person I invited 15 months ago from now was Max Lucado. But because Max is on an annual discipline for his book that rolls out, this is just not a time of year that he could come. So 15 months ago, he told me no for 2013. 6 months ago, I asked him 18 months in advance for 2014. But again, because of his discipline in writing and his devotion to his church and his family, he told me no. But 7 days ago, when I wrote him and said, "Max, you know Rick has lost his son, and he's just made what I think is a wonderful decision to back out and take a 3-month speaking sabbatical," speaking as one who's buried a child, "and you're my first choice if that's at all possible." And within an hour, I had an email that I love saying, "Mike, give me a call." And so it goes back to that. So thank you, Max. I did want to mention, this is not the first favor Max has done for me. Back in the late 1980s, I wrote a book, and there was a young missionary in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, who had just published a book called On the Anvil. He was about to move to San Antonio. I really liked his writing, so I asked Max to write the foreword to my book, which he did. By that time, they'd moved to San Antonio. I called another buddy of mine preaching at another San Antonio church and said, I want to really put on the dog to thank him. So tell me the best restaurant in San Antonio, and I'm going to buy a gift certificate. So I bought a $50 gift certificate, and I sent it to Max. And Max went to this restaurant, do you remember? And it didn't have prices on it. You remember that? It had no prices. But Max was as much of a bumpkin as I was at the time. And he thought, I've got a $50 gift certificate. So he and Dinalyn ordered everything and got a nice dessert and a little coffee afterwards. And he told me later they had to wash dishes to get out of there. So I want you to know I got another $50 gift certificate waiting here. But don't spend it at Duke's. Max was for years a missionary in Rio de Janeiro, along with Dinalyn. 1988, they moved to San Antonio, where he has been minister for the Oak Hills Church since then. Max has written almost 100 books. There are about 80 million copies of his books in print in every imaginable language. He was named by Christianity Today as America's pastor, which I think is appropriate. What's that? I thought you knew. And we're so thankful to Dinalyn sharing him at last moment. And they have three daughters, Jenna and Andrea and Sarah. We're grateful for them and the wonderful young women they are. I got to teach a couple of them. But I'd like to pray now and ask God's blessings on Max, especially on this busy day of travel that he's had and that many of you have had. We are grateful, God, for Max's life, for his voice, for his pen, and especially for his heart. We're grateful for the way that he has shaped people in the way of Jesus by word and by life. And I pray that you will bless him as he teaches. We are so grateful to be here to learn, to share. May the Lord bless him now. In the name of Christ, we pray. And we all say, amen. Would you welcome Max Lucado?
Well, good afternoon, everybody. Well, we made it, didn't we? Here we are. Morning when I woke up in San Antonio, there was a voicemail from American Airlines saying the flight was delayed. And so I just poured another cup of coffee and I sent a message to Mike. I said, you know, if you want to go ahead and go with another plan, he told me, he said, a minute ago, he said, well, I'd already done that once. And so I just pulled in and I'm really, really grateful to be here, and it turns out to be a phenomenal opportunity for me to just publicly acknowledge my condolences to my friend Rick Warren, and the deep and long-lasting respect I have for him and Kay, and may God continue to bless and to heal them. And what a privilege to be a part of this event, which is Mike's first time serving as wrangler of this event, following our dear friend Jerry Rushford. And it's just great to be here to wish him the best and pray the best on his ministry as he serves all the people of the kingdom and all the people who come to this great event. I just can't pull on the campus without having all these memories come back of some of the sweetest people in the world. Norval Young. I always think of Norval Young when I come on the Pepperdine. Am I alone in that? My favorite line of Norval Young's was this: we're living in a day of answered prayer. We're living in the day of answered prayer. I may be misquoting that, but that's how I remember it. And we are, aren't we? We're living in a difficult time, for sure. But this is a day of answered prayer. And Jerry Rushford, my goodness, what a good man. And my favorite line from Jerry's is how Jerry would conclude the lectures every year. And he would always use this line. It was something like this: if you look long and hard enough, you will find something wrong with this week. I've used that with my church several times. You know, if you look long and hard enough, you're going to find something wrong everywhere you go. That's true in life. But you know, it's hard to find something wrong with the Pepperdine lectures. And may God continue to bless this great history, this great legacy. Bill Banowski, I pulled up, I hadn't thought about Bill Banowski in forever, and Bill Young, and all the great shoulders upon which we stand today in our own faith. Many of you influenced by them and by the many, many speakers who have come through here over these many, many years. What a vision even to have this wonderful university. And it's just an honor for me to have a small part in it. I do bring you greetings from San Antonio, Texas. They are so glad when I leave town. They have had their fill of me. I've been there 25 years. 25 years. That's a long time. And they're just so happy when we have guest speakers. The other day, after the service, it's been about 3 or 4 weeks ago, a young man came up to me, maybe 13 or 14 years old, and he said, I just want to tell you, that's the worst sermon I've ever heard you preach. Why are you laughing? I said, what? He came up to me about a week later, and he said, I was wrong last week. Well, in an elders meeting not long thereafter, I said to the elders, I said, you got to do something about this kid. He's really discouraging me. And one of the elders said, oh, Max, don't pay him any mind. He only repeats what he hears. We have those hand dryers in our bathrooms. You know, you hit the button and a burst of hot air comes out. Somebody wrote on a sticky note and put it on one of those for a brief message from our minister. Hit this button. And they're always telling me my sermons are too long. You probably never have to put up with long sermons, but they're always telling me my sermons are too long. Not too long ago, right in the middle of one of my messages, somebody, a gentleman, stood up and he started walking out. I stopped everything. I said, sir, where are you going? He said, I'm going to get a haircut. I said, well, why didn't you get one before you came in? He said, I didn't need one before I came in. For some people, that is the decision of discipleship. Not to do more, but to trust more. So what does Jesus do? I think he does for us what he did for the woman caught in the act of adultery. We know, right, that these stories are in the Bible not just to show us what Jesus did, but to show us what a living Jesus does right now. What did he do for her? He stooped. What does he do for you? He stoops. He enters your world through the voice of a friend, through the embrace of a spouse, through the kindness of a scripture, even through the message of a preacher. He stoops to enter your world. Would you right now open yourself up to the very possibility that Jesus Christ, the King of the universe, is stooping to speak to your heart at this moment with comfort? With kindness, he stoops, just like he stooped to be born in Bethlehem and to walk the shores of Galilee and the streets of Jerusalem. He stoops. Grace is the God who stoops, who comes in. And you think you're low, he goes lower. He made himself to be sin for us, so that in him we could become the righteousness of God. Stoop low enough to be nailed to a cross, low enough to take a final breath and to shed that crimson blood for our sins. Stoop low. He stooped. But then what did he do? He stood to validate his coming, is his standing. He stood. Right in the middle of the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea, he stood. Stood right in defiance of the devil himself, he stood. Demons scattered and Satan was last seen with tail tucked between legs, scampering out of the cemetery. He stood. He stood. And he spoke. And here's what you need to know.
He's still speaking right now. At the right hand of God, you have what the woman had in Jerusalem. You know what you have? You have an advocate. You have an advocate, dear child of God. You have an advocate. Whoever lives to make intercession for you, who positions himself in between you and your accuser, whose job is to be your intercessor. And since he will live forever, he will always be there to remind God that he has paid for our sins with his blood, and that he is in the presence of God at this very moment doing what? Sticking up for us. So when Satan comes into the kingdom, into the throne room of the kingdom with his accusations, Jesus stands and he comes between you and your accuser. And what Jesus did for her, Jesus does for you. But what Jesus does for you is even more than what he did for her. Wave upon wave, prepare yourself. Because Jesus gave her his help. But Jesus gives you his heart. His heart. That when you give your heart to Jesus, he returns the favor in a supernatural miracle. And he places within you and within me a brand new heart. I'm not telling you anything, just reminding you that in the Bible, the heart is symbolic of the want to and the can do, desire and ability. And so when God talks about giving a brand new heart to his people, he's saying, I'm going to give you new desires and new ability. So grace becomes more than just the word to describe what God did for us, but it becomes the word that describes what God does inside us. He moves in. You remember the Old Testament prophecy from Ezekiel 36, then I will sprinkle clean water on you and you shall be clean. I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and all your idols. There's wave one, but prepare yourself for wave number two. I will give you a new heart. I will put a new spirit within you. When you give Jesus your heart, the wonder of it all, he gives you his. He removes your heart, poisoned as it is with pride and pain and all the mistakes of the past. And he places within you a brand new heart. No other religion in the history of the world dares to make such a claim. No other movement implies the living presence of its founder in its followers. Muhammad does not indwell Muslims. Buddha does not inhabit Hindus. Joseph Smith does not indwell Mormons. Hugh Hefner does not indwell the hedonist. Influence, inspire, enable, instruct, but occupy. Yet we Christians embrace this inscrutable promise. Paul said, Christ in you. Christ in you. The hope of glory. Todd and Tara Storch really understand this as much as anyone might. Todd and Tara, wonderful family from Dallas, Texas. They were blessed with three children. And in the spring of 2010, they went on a family ski trip to Colorado. Their beautiful 13-year-old daughter, Taylor, died in a tragic accident on the mountain. And what followed for Tara and Todd was every parent's worst nightmare. A funeral, a burial, a flood of questions and tears. And they decided to donate their daughter's organs to needy patients. Few people needed a heart more than Patricia Winters. Her heart had begun to fail some 5 years earlier, leaving her too weak to do much more than sleep, but Taylor's heart gave her a fresh start on life. Tara, Taylor's mom, had only one request. She wanted to hear the heartbeat of her daughter one more time. Through a curious series of events, Patricia Winters and Tara Storch got in contact with each other, and Todd and Tara flew from Dallas to Phoenix to the home of Patricia, and the two mothers embraced for a long time, soon to be joined by Todd. After a few moments, Tara took the stethoscope and she placed it against Patricia's chest. There's a web page that tells this story. Taylorsgift.org recreates this moment in which Tara heard her daughter's heartbeat again. "It's so strong," she said. Patricia said, "Oh yes, it's a strong heart." "I want Todd to hear it," she said, and handed the stethoscope to her husband. And the two parents took turns listening to their daughter's heart. The reason I tell you that story is so I can ask you this question. When Todd and Tara heard that heartbeat, whose heart did they hear? Did they not hear the still beating heart of their daughter? Oh, dear child of God, when God hears your heart right now, whose heart does he hear? Does he not hear the still beating heart of his son, Jesus Christ? Because when you gave your heart to him, he returned the favor and placed within you the heart of Jesus Christ. This is the mystery of our faith. I don't know how I missed this for so many years. I believed that Christ was for me, near me, behind me, above me, beneath me, around me. I believed every other preposition. How did I go so long without the awareness that Jesus was in me? I can't fault the Apostle Paul. Paul refers to this union 216 times. If my wife tells me something three times, I'm supposed to get it. 216 times. One time, you're not going to believe this. One time he went so far as to say, "It is no longer I who lives, but Christ who lives," where? You already read this. "But Christ who lives in me." Can you imagine getting to the point in your life where one morning you wake up and you look in the mirror and you say, "I don't think that's me anymore." But steady, day by day by day, the Christ who moved in has reclaimed what is rightfully his. My emotions, my thoughts, my mind, my hand, my want to, my can do. He has steadily, day by day by day, reclaimed what is rightfully his. And now as I look in the mirror, I don't even think what I used to think. I don't hate who I used to hate. I'm not as critical as I used to be. Is that me in the mirror? It is no longer I, but Christ who lives in me, who lives in me. You see, God's dream isn't just to get you to heaven, but to get heaven inside of you. A radical new nature indwells you, dear friend. A radical new nature indwells you. And as that nature grows and increases, you become less and less you and more him. Wave enough to wash away your sins, but the wave also enough to change you, to transform you from one degree of glory to the next. You say, Max, that sounds good, but if I have Christ's heart in me, then why do I still behave so much like me? If I have his heart, why do I still have these habits? Well, there's a good answer to that question. Transplants take time. Right? I have a guy or a guy in our church, cardiologist, he performs a transplant average a week, heart transplant, real successful heart surgeon in South Texas. I asked him one day, just to make sure. I said, if somebody has a heart transplant today, can they run a marathon tomorrow? And he laughed at me, just like you did. He chuckled. He said, no. I said, does that mean then they did not get a new heart? He says, no, they got a new heart. It just has to acclimate. The presence of the struggle does not imply the absence of the miracle. It is a miracle that happens. Nothing short of a new birth that happens. That whenever somebody looks with faith toward the Christ who died for them, there is a miracle that happens. The struggles will continue, but here's the good news. They're going to diminish. As one of my friends says, I'm not sinless, but I am starting to sin less. Isn't this good news? Maybe you can't control your anxiety, but Jesus can, and he lives inside you. Maybe you can't stop gossiping, but Jesus can, and he lives inside you. Maybe you can't put up with that jerk who lives next door or forgive that person who broke your heart, but Jesus can. And he lives inside you. I got to tell you, folks, this is exciting stuff. And it is transforming this old boy you're looking at. I'm nearly 60 years old. I've been in ministry, entering my fourth decade as a minister. And I've got more energy now, more passion, more excitement, more optimism, because I'm learning that it is the ever-increasing, growing, glorious presence of Jesus Christ reclaiming what is rightfully his. And it's not so much what I do, but more who I trust. It's a mystery, I know. I'd love to package it and box it up and condense it all down to a page, but every time I think I do, wave upon wave. I think the Lord would like to douse you today. I do. And I just have a hunch. I'm looking into the faces of some really good people who do a lot. But something in my heart is saying, would you just be? Would you just, at least for the rest of my message today, just be. Just be God's child. Just let him be inside you. Just trust him. Just receive him. Just believe him. He has moved into you. He must really think highly of you. I know you're a reclamation project just like I am. But he's doing a pretty good job. last year, where are we, in May? Yeah, so it's been a full year now. Someone sent me a YouTube video of some girls who posted a tribute to their mother. I watched the YouTube video, and I emailed the guy who sent it. He's on our staff, and I said, that's a great story. He said, you don't know the half of it. I said, those two girls go to our church. I said, you're kidding me. And so I got in contact with him, and I asked him if I could take that video with me as I go and speak at different places, because as much as any story I've seen, it communicates the grace of Christ. Now, this is a Mother's Day tribute, and Mother's Day is just a few weeks away, a few days away, so it's especially appropriate now, right? It only takes 2 minutes. I want you to watch it, and then I'm going to come up and wrap the message up. That's ruthless, isn't it? My favorite joke these days, my wife tells me not to tell, but since she's not here, I'm going to tell it. It's a story about a guy who goes into a doctor's office to have a mole removed from his chin. He tells the nurse, who's somewhat of a husky sort, I'm here to have a mole removed from my chin. She didn't even look up. She said, down the hall, first door to the right, remove all your clothes and sit down. He said, I'm just here to have a mole removed from my chin. She's kind of gruff lady. She said, I said, down the hall, first door to the right, remove all your clothes and sit down. He said, man, maybe you don't understand. She looked up. She said, maybe you don't understand. Down the hall, first door to the right, remove all your clothes and sit down. A little bit intimidated. He went down the hall, first door to the right, open the door, lo and behold, there's a naked man sitting on a stool in the corner. He said to the naked man, quite a nurse out there. And the man said, you're telling me I'm just the UPS driver. I don't know why she doesn't like that joke. I can't come to California without thinking of my Uncle Billy. Now, Uncle Billy lived in Anaheim for most of his adult life, even though he was raised with where my father was raised in West Texas. But at a young age, Uncle Billy got a job with the Santa Fe Railroad and moved to California prior to World War II. And he spent all of his adult years in Anaheim. It was a big day when my dad told the Lucado family back in West Texas, we're all going to California on vacation to see Uncle Billy. I was 10 years of age. I'd never been to California. I had never seen an ocean. Now, many of you find that hard to believe. I've shared that story with people, and they say, are you kidding? You lived to be 10 years of age, and you'd never seen an ocean? I had never seen a lake that was larger than a city block. I'd seen a lot of cattle tanks and horse troughs. I'd never really seen a river. I'd seen creeks. So you can imagine. Can you imagine what it must be like for a 10-year-old boy to see the Pacific Ocean?
I can still remember. I almost think I could find the place. I know I couldn't. But it's indelibly stenciled in my memory, standing on a beach, looking at the immensity, the endless stretch, that horizon of water. And I turned to my Uncle Billy, watching those waves slap against the water and pull back out, waves slap and then pull back out. I turned to him and I said, "Uncle Billy, it just keeps coming." You see, if you've never seen an ocean, not only have you never seen the immensity of it, you've never seen waves like that. He said to me, "I know." He said, "This happens at night too." And he said, "If you were to come back in December, it keeps coming." My brother and I went swimming for the first time in the ocean. We had our bathing suits on. We waded out in the water. Never felt anything like it. Struggled to get back up to my feet. Got back up on my feet. It just kept coming. Did you know that there is a grace of God that just keeps coming? That just when you think you've got it figured out, just when you think you've out-sinned the grace, it just keeps coming. How long has it been since you've been soaked to the bone by the grace of God? There's something about this grace of God, this relentless, this rumbling, this tumbling, this pulling, this tide that just keeps coming into anyone who is willing to stand on the shoreline of God's hope. There is a grace that never stops. Maybe that's why the Apostle Paul was so committed to tell his young student Timothy, "If you're going to be strong in anything," he said, "be strong in the grace that is yours in Christ Jesus." And then that admonition in Hebrews, it says, "See to it that no one misses the grace of God, and that no bitter root springs up to defile many." Paul says, if you're going to be strong in anything, Timothy, be strong in the grace, be muscular in the grace, exercise in the workroom of grace. Be articulate in grace. Be swamped in grace. We all have our favorite stories of grace in the Bible, but since I'm preaching, I get to pick the one we're going to look at, right? You'll remember it. It's in John's Gospel, chapter 8. Early the next morning, Jesus was back again at the temple. A crowd soon gathered, and he sat down and he taught them. And while he was speaking, the teachers of religious law and Pharisees brought a woman they had caught in the act of adultery. And they put her in front of the crowd. "Teacher," they said to Jesus, "this woman was caught in the very act of adultery. And the law of Moses says to stone her. What do you say?" The voices yanked her out of bed that morning. "Get out of bed, you harlot. What kind of woman do you think you are?" Voices of accusation and criticism. The priest slammed open the bedroom door and yanked back the curtains. And before she felt the warmth of the morning sun, she felt the heat of their religious scorn. They yanked back the covers and they pulled her out of bed. And they began to drag her through the narrow streets of Jerusalem. The roosters scampered to get out of the way and the dogs barked And the mamas reached out and pulled their children back just in time and covered their eyes. And the daddies turned and looked, and the merchants turned and stared. And if that parade of shame were not enough, they took the woman to, of all places, an early morning Bible study where Jesus had gathered in the square, in the open area with his followers. And the Bible says that he was seated. Jesus sat down. And so Jesus was sitting down, and probably his students were as well. And in my imagination, I can just see the religious leaders finally frocked and angry-faced, taking the woman and shoving her into the middle of the crowd. Maybe some of the students stood to get out of the way. And I'm imagining it was tough for her to maintain her balance. Maybe she couldn't. And there she fell face first, clutching her nightie, lipstick smeared, and a horseshoe of pastors and leaders gather around her. "Teacher," they say, "this woman was caught. Caught, snagged, grabbed, caught." That's a good verb we'll later learn. She really is a part of a trap, which may explain the absence of the man. I don't know. She's been caught. But really, she is the cheese, and we'll learn Jesus is the mouse. But she was caught to hopefully catch him. She's been caught in the act, in the moment, in the embrace, in the bed, caught in the act of adultery. And the law of Moses says we're supposed to throw rocks at her. Do you think by now that the men had begun to pick up stones? Is there any chance that as she, from her position on the ground, looked up waist level with the men, she could see them squeezing these stones until their fingertips turned white? The law of Moses says we're supposed to stone her. What do you say? And from face to face to face, she looked, and she didn't see any kindness, any compassion. Nobody's going to speak up for her. Nobody's going to help her. But somebody is going to stoop for her. You preachers, next time you preach John 8, use the postures of Jesus as your outline. John wants us to follow Jesus' varying elevations. He sat down to teach, but then John says, Jesus stooped down. He stooped down, and he wrote in the dust. So the sitting Jesus becomes the stooping Jesus. Why do you think Jesus stooped down, and what do you think he wrote? Why did he stoop? And what did he write? Everybody's always wondered, haven't they? What was he writing in the ground? Billy Graham said, this is the only sermon Jesus ever wrote. What do you think he wrote in the dust? You can't have a Bible study on John 8 without somebody saying, what was he writing in the dust? I think I know. If you'll remind me at the end of the message, I'll tell you. Why did he stoop? John Stott said, grace is the God who stoops. I've wondered if it wasn't so that she would no longer be the lowest one in the circle. Because you see, everyone was looking down on her. Maybe you know what that's like. Maybe people have looked down on you in your life.
Maybe you know what it's like to be at the low end of the pecking order, the bottom rung of the ladder. Maybe Jesus was going lower as if to say, all right, if you're going to look at me, you got to look even farther. He stooped. Grace is the God who stoops. Jesus was prone to do this, wasn't he? Prone to stoop low enough to be born in a stable, placed in a manger, low enough to be raised in a map dot of a town and nondescript Nazareth, to spend 3 decades in anonymity, God in the flesh. How low he stooped. He condescended. He entered our world. But they demanded an answer, John says. They just kept demanding an answer. Verse 7, they kept demanding an answer. So, what did he do? Stood up. So the sitting Jesus, who became the stooping Jesus, now becomes the standing Jesus. He stood up. Didn't stand for long because he's going to stoop down in just a moment. Again, using my imagination, I just see him standing, looking at her accusers, placing himself in between her and them. All right, he said. Stoner! Stoner! But let the one of you who has never sinned throw the first stone. Now you got to really press your ear up against your Bible here. But if you do, and you press it real tight, and you tell everybody else to be very quiet, right about this point in John chapter 8, you'll begin to hear this. Drop, drop, drop. One stone after another after another. They drop their stones. And then John says, beginning, when they heard this, they slipped away one by one, beginning with the oldest. Again, another great detail, right, from John? You think our ever balding heads and thinning hair cause us to have a better perspective of how much we've sinned? So these silver-haired guys turned, beginning with the eldest, one by one. They came in mass. They came in a posse. And they leave one by one by one. Can I have that rock back? Until only Jesus is left standing. He wasn't finished. He asked her the question in verse 10. He said, where are your accusers? My, what a question. Not just for her, but for us. I have a hunch that I'm speaking to somebody who, maybe even this morning, was awakened with voices of condemnation and accusation. You're not good enough. You're not strong enough. You don't give enough. You don't serve enough. You're not faithful enough. Oh, these voices that come in our world. And these voices in our head. Who is this morality patrolman who seems to issue a citation at every stumble? Does he ever shut up? You could do better. Why aren't you more like your friend, your spouse, your sister? Do these voices of accusation ever shut up? They don't. And here's why. Because they come from the devil. Yes, I believe there is a devil. I believe there is a malevolent, evil force who's on a short leash and a limited timetable. But he has one goal. And that is to suck the joy out of God's people.
The Apostle John calls him the accuser. He said, this great dragon, the ancient serpent called the devil or Satan, is the one deceiving the whole world, was thrown down to earth with all his angels. For the accuser has been thrown down to earth, the one who accused our brothers and our sisters day and night. Satan cannot take your salvation, but he tries to take your joy, your fruit, your faith, your happiness. He cries to take what he can. And he comes in as the accuser, whispering ever these voices in your ear, hoping to render you without happiness, without faith, without hope, and without security. And he's got a lot of demons to help him. And he recruits a lot of people to help him, friends who dredge up your past, or preachers who preach all guilt and no grace, or even parents. One of my friends tells me that he thinks his mom must have owned a travel agency that specialized in guilt trips. He said, she took me on a different one every day. Maybe you were raised in a home of condemnation. Maybe the earliest voices you heard were voices of criticism and accusation, and there's something in your system that's just hardwired to resist the idea of God's grace coming at you like a tidal wave, washing away, cleansing, changing, restoring, renewing. For some people, it's a lifelong project to learn to trust God's grace. In fact, for